Welcome to the Richfield Library, and thank you to the library. I'm Tracy Moore, Director of Public Programs at the Aldrich, and again, thank you all for being here today for this very special program. On behalf of the Aldrich, I do want to thank again the library, our ongoing partner in collaborative programming. We're so grateful for their generosity and commitment to thought-provoking and engaging content like today. Last but certainly not least, I would like to thank David Brooks, who you will meet in a few minutes, and our distinguished speaker, Timothy Morton. It has truly been an honor to work with both of you on the program, so thank you so much. I would like to introduce my colleague, Aldrich curator, Amy Smith-Stewart.
Thank you, Tracy. Welcome and thank you so much for coming. I'm just briefly going to introduce David Brooks. David Brooks grew up in Brazil, Indiana. He received his BFA from the Cooper Union in New York and his MFA from Columbia University. Besides being a full-time artist and professor at the Maryland Institute College of Art, Brooks spends long stretches of time on volunteer research and expeditions in the Florida Everglades, the Amazon, the Guyana rainforest, and elsewhere as a field team member working alongside conservation biologists to discover unknown fish and bird species and exploring areas with vast and rich ecosystems. His experience working with these scientists for over a decade has conditioned him to perceive things, he says, in deep time scenarios. His practice is often riddled with an exploration of the tenuous relationship between our ecological life and technological industry. Working within what Brooks deems real scale dimension is something of a trope, evident in his present exhibition at the Aldrich, Continuous Service Altered Daily. A sprawling sight-engaged sculptural array, a procession of every single part of a 1976 John Deere combine harvester, and in other monumental commissions, such as Desert Rooftops, a 5,000 square foot urban earthwork in Times Square, produced for the Art Production Fund in 2011, Preserve Forest, presented at MoMA PS1 in 2010, comprised of 20 tons of concrete and 30-foot tall trees of Amazonian origin. And in 2012, a proverbial machine in the garden at Storm King, where he entombed a tractor in concrete compartments within a man-made hill. As Brooks explains, the work has to be realized in real, not representational scale. Moreover, it is intricately linked to its site and the myriad ways of defining what a site is. Brooks's work pulls from particularities of land art, Duchamp's ready-mades, minimalism, and the current ecological crisis. He indicates that his work is comprised of actions, not simply objects, as they employ the conventionally made. In other words, the man-made, machines, asphalt shingle rooftops, greenhouse grown trees, used to conceive an exceptional composition, a burial, a dunescape, a petrified forest, a procession, particular to its setting. To consider the natural world versus the built environment, he says, one must work from within an evolving or evolutionary vernacular. A vintage tractor's return to dirt. Storm King once farmland is today a pastoral sculpture park. A displaced forest is desiccated in concrete. The Amazon rainforest is shrinking as a result of predatory developers and at risk of becoming a desert preserved forest. A combined harvester is eviscerated. An ecosystem is reduced to a life-supporting system, continuous service, altered daily. Brooks's installations function as allegories, reminding us that an artwork, in his words, can be a document of present conditions. It is also a response to its failings, but it is also an experiential moment that can potentially incite a sense of agency in its audience, since it is they who shape a future. Thank you very much. I'm now happy to hand over the mic to David Brooks, who will introduce Continuous Service Altered Daily and Timothy Morton. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody, for coming, and thank you to Tim Morton for making his way from the southern state of Texas, and to everybody else who trekked in from afar. Both this exhibition at the Aldrich and kind of what we're talking about today is really one of many attempts at trying to kind of reassess or redefine the notion of an ecosystem. And so for me to do that from my own side of things here, I'm going to talk for about 10 to 15 minutes, give you some backstory on me and this attempt at this definition of an ecosystem, as well as I'll show you a little bit of the process of making the exhibition at the Aldrich. After our talk here, we're going to have a reception back at the museum where you can see the exhibition in situ. So in order for me to give some backstory, though, I need to kind of go back to 1997, when I was but a wee little skinny lad on the left there, disgustingly thin, clearly far more handsome today. And so that was my first trip to the Amazon in 1997 at the age of, I think I was 19 or 20. Anyhow, I had many reasons for wanting to go, but the Amazon is this place of great stereotypes and cliches, and many of them still ring true. It's a place of great exploitation, both of the natural resources and the indigenous peoples, but also it is a place where the definitions or the limitations of our knowledge is truly tested, both physically in terms of trying to get around the place, just physically and logistically, but also in terms of the more we know there and the more we study, the more we realize we don't know. So it is a place of fragility and this kind of organic abyss. And so I've been really fascinated with these Amazonian regions for quite a while now, for many of those reasons. Working with ornithologists, bird tagging, migratory species. This was in Venezuela. Even just this past January in Guyana, we're working with the Peabody Museum at Yale and cattle doing a biodiversity survey of the region. Herpetologists with our little trio there, and even geologists and limnologists, people who study kind of the nutrients of water. This is in Colombia and Venezuela. It's primarily these little guys here that we, the lead biologists that I've done a lot of these trips with are always looking at. These are lower caridae or armored catfish, and their evolutionary history is one that continues to radiate out the more we learn of them. So it's one of these kind of keystone species that really tests this limit of where, how we even begin to define what a species is. And so for me, doing the field work, I mean, I'd make a really bad scientist, but I make an okay sort of anthropologist of scientists, specifically in the field. And watching them work, I realized that what they're really doing, which I think is quite radical and avant-garde, is they're thinking about these living beings in their hands in terms of millions of years. And so this act of combining the scale of deep time, that of millions of years, with the living in the moment is something that I certainly think a lot about and try and resolve in the work of my work, but it's something I see them doing kind of almost intuitively, even though they are working under a kind of scientific rigor. This is actually a fish I named after an undergrad art teacher. Her name was Erzi Schwartz, and this is Ancestress E. Schwartzi, in order to Latinize it. This is a fish that, in the same family of fish that's evolved to look like wood. This is one that's evolved to be able to eat wood and actually digest wood, one of the few animals that can actually do that. So all of this, though, is also a way of getting closer to the living world, but never really certainly getting like in it in a different kind of way. It's certainly picture building, creating pictures and measurements, but it's an active one. And so this idea of being in the field amongst amongst this living, tactile kind of matter, the mucking around, comes into interesting conflict when it's also an act of cataloging. And so for me, this is like field science is also a moment where we can begin to see where the limitations of even attempting to categorize this in a rational manner begins to break down into an irrational other kind of space that I find really interesting and it is very human. So this idea, though, of like the tactile and the physical, and how does one even begin to put together those relationships between you as a living being and a body and the non-human living world? And so there's been many attempts I've done over the last 6 or 7 years here that I'll show you briefly here. This is a cross-section of an Amazonian forest that I planted in PS1 in the duplex gallery and then covered in 20 tons of concrete. which was very much an action here, not necessarily composition. And over time, the monumentality of the piece began to decay, fall apart, but really change. And this idea of transformation is one that I think subverts image. When we see images of deforestation and like a sort of large-scale violence on the landscape, there's kind of a desaturation or desensitization, rather, not a desaturation, but an oversaturation that begins to kick in. And so there's something very odd and strange about that. So with this project, I was wanting to make it very visceral. And so for me, this is very much a visceral portrait of these notions. Here, this is the trees begin to grow back over time. So this is something I can't necessarily compose, of course, but something that does actually result. And so, and again, subverting image and really this thing being active and participating with the viewer. Just a couple of years ago in Art Basel, Switzerland, for the statements sector there, which is where they do sort of 10 to 20 solo exhibitions, I brought in, so Art Basel being arguably the place where there's more money spent on contemporary subjectivity than any one point in time and place in the world. So what I did is I brought in five living fish from the Amazon that were unknown to science. They have no species name. So, but they are circulating in these kind of high-end aquarium trade. So where exactly the definition of what they are or how we might define them is kind of in flux. And so I position them on a set of bleachers here, and then people can kind of observe these living beings as living beings for what they are, in a sense, or at least reassess how they are considered. And the fish are very uninterested in the viewers. And so they would kind of stare out. They're very nearsighted, and they would kind of stare back out at the glass as people would get close, completely uninterested. And they live, they're not ambushers. They actually can eat wood fibers, and they live under the logs. So they're very sedentary creatures. So it was very uncanny kind of living being confronting the Damien Hirsts across the aisle. Also, this is the Desert Rooftops piece in Times Square, where I fashioned a series of suburban-style asphalt-shingled rooftops, but really to resemble a series of sand dunes, a different kind of landscape, plopped down into the middle of Times Square area, really modeled after this interpretive sign, which is positioned there. It's all kind of sand dune landscapes, like what you might see at a national park system on a trail, where it's supposed to tell you what it means, but here what we have are diagrams about how sand dunes are formed and some information about desertification, when land is over-cultivated and rendered inhospitable to other life forms, which this might be another version of that desertification in our built environment. So kind of trying to look at ways to, again, relate the ecosystem both in a formal and conceptual level back to the built environment. Here, actually, working with exoticized animal forms next to real living seabirds that were being rehabilitated down in the Florida Keys. And as I learned, the pelicans were really like the Jackson Pollocks, leaving their guano drippings on these kind of exoticized animal forms, or big blankets of guano across the forms. And the egrets were really the kind of Bruegels of the animal world with very delicate lines. And so these then were reassembled back into the museum, complete with their finished patina of guano, where real life being lived, the indexical traces of life lived, come into direct contact with a kind of cultured or cultivated notion of what the wilds might be. A couple more just to show you and give you some background. These were various cherry pickers that I've installed around the country in different places where they almost sprout up like weeds or opportunistic species, which is actually the terminology used by biologists in describing gap ecology. When weeds reach into these big light gaps, they are opportunists. They capitalize on momentary shafts of light, which in a way is also could be seen as a way to talk about gentrification or the way that our own built environment moves and is opportunistic in its own right. This was in Toronto for the No Eat Blanche. In Storm King, then, this is the piece Amy was mentioning where buried an entire tractor, complete with a backhoe and a front loader. Storm King, if you haven't been there, is a sculpture park started in 1964. And the entire landscape is completely man-made, but it's rendered to look as though it is really the quintessential pastoral landscape. And if you kind of look at the aesthetic mandates laid out there, and if you read Friedrich Law Olmsted's mandates of what makes the pastoral in an image, and if you compare it then also to maybe some Wenzel Homer paintings or church, you'll actually see these aesthetic ideals kind of played out in actual land itself. And so with this piece called Proverbial Machine in the Garden, the idea was to very simply put the machine itself back into this garden. And with a bit of kind of ambiguousness as to which one's really dominant. But it being the vessel or the interface with this natural world, or that being the tractor. Mm. And so with the Aldrich then, coming here, I wanted to think more about how to get inside of this interface instead of just using the interface, but actually get inside the interface and to kind of embody the interface. So if we, the combine harvester, or more often just referred to as a combine, which is a piece of farming technology going back 130 years or so now, maybe 150. That's a modern day combine there in the bottom. It's a piece of technology that does many functions all at one time. Any one human individual's attempt at trying to perceive all of its functions at one time as an impossibility. A little bit, for me, like the impossibility of witnessing an entire ecosystem, all of its functions all at one time. The idea of witnessing an ecosystem is kind of an interesting anomaly because you can't really show up to the Everglades or the Adirondacks and just witness ecosystem. You have to, through your own experiences in that place, through data, information about what has actually been studied in the region, in addition to your own imagination and putting it back together, sort of the moment of actually witnessing. And so for me, it was an interesting moment in thinking about how our relationship to other life forms on the Earth and certainly larger systems play out collectively in our built environments. And so to get past the interface itself, that of the combine, but to actually take the combine apart, where we can begin to get inside of it in all of its pieces, and we begin to kind of see all of its pieces in their own right as individual objects, discrete objects, but also as part of a whole. So the idea was to spread it across the floor plan of the Aldrich ground floor, almost like a beast that's been disemboweled in a sense, or an asteroid field kind of spread out through the museum without really distinguishable kind of beginning or end necessarily. And then this image here showing how this, so you could see that there's kind of four, what I would say are four modes of process happening, four modes of transformation, or maybe call them four modes of taxonomy. One being the combine as a whole and it's all of its functions. Another one being the combine in all of its pieces as it's strewn across the museum. The combine in its various material transformations goes from, in the beginning of the museum, the pieces are left in its wear and tear state because it's a 40-year-old piece of machinery. And then as it moves into the next phase, they're all sandblasted. So all the pieces have been returned to their material origin in a way, all evidence of wear and tear erased, except for on the surface at least. And then the next phase where they're brass plated, as it moves off to the right there. So all the elements kind of elevated in a sense in their kind of preciousness of the object, almost in a museological way. And then in the back, as it kind of dwindles down the back of the sculpture garden, they're gold powder coated. And so these different ways of transformation is another kind of taxonomy. But to go back to one of the earlier ones, also was an attempt to really find the inner Brancusis in the piece. So really to think about the individual objects, whether it's the bolt or a nut, or whether it's a gear, or whether it's an axle, whatever it may be, to actually think about them compositionally, relationally, aesthetically, as individual objects that have their own merit as individuals, but also knowing certainly that these inner Brancusis are ultimately tied to this whole autonomous machine that actually is an interface with this larger transformation of landscape. Mm. So this is actually the 1976 combine that we got, perfectly functioning, beautifully functioning. We, of course, begin to disassemble this. And these process images are all courtesy of David Gelfman, who I'm not sure if he's here today or not, but who helped this, technically helping take this thing apart, which was quite a prodigious enterprise. So as you can see, for me, the idea that it really is a performative sculpture, one that the process of its making and disassembly is equally as important as the objects currently and statically, or appearing to be static, in the museum context itself. Sorting the hundreds upon hundreds of pieces and beginning to assign them different zones, different ways of surface treatment, and relationships both in their origin or their placement within the machine, as well as in museological kind of orderings within the museum itself. Here is kind of a what we can see in the middle, the wear and tear state, on the right, the sandblasted, and on the left are early tests for the brass plating, and then the gold powder coating. And just a couple pictures of the actual installation, because you'll see it in situ for yourself after this. But initially, there is kind of a sense of it being an exploded drawing. But that idea, which we are familiar with, the idea of a piece of machinery being exploded out into a two-dimensional rendering, but that then gets interjected with things like this, where it's detoxification and decomposition of waste, which actually has nothing to do with a combine harvester in the very initial read of that. But these are nine different ecosystems that I interjected into these zones in order to kind of problematize or reassess where the viewer's relationship to these objects are. In other words, if I come to this, and this is all in the water purification zone, and I rethink what perhaps the cleaning fan's relationship are to water particulates or settling of silt, there is a reassessment that happens both with the viewer and the object themselves simultaneously. So it's this kind of absurdist, poetic kind of reassessment that activates it, very much like, in my mind, what an ecosystem does, which is an active participating, being present, and reflecting, both in retrospect and in the moment of actually engaging these objects. Here we have fungal breakdown and sponges from some of these items here, which are the sandblasted kind of entrails from the machine. And here we have all the drive chains that have been sandblasted, which is almost looks like static electricity in how they're composed in this situation. But here they're called air particulates. Again, air purification and a sampling of every single piece of fastening hardware used in the entire combine, which is referred to here simply, obviously, as decaying leaves. What I call referred to as the Egyptian room is actually the ornamental resources room. If we think about the ecosystems in terms of ornamental resources in a conventional way, it's really just this idea that it provides an aesthetic kind of replenishment or an aesthetic kind of alleviation, in a sense. And the last couple of images I'm going to leave you with as we go out to the back of the museum. We have our sort of mini Richard Serra there on the lower right, and the pieces that trickle on down into the landscape and become a bit kind of integrated with the landscape and the different scales that happen simultaneously. So, and so I think, you know, it is that interaction with the work, as I was showing this ideas of completing the piece both through the placards that designate different ecosystem zones and the titling, but with the actual objects themselves, where it becomes kind of a one that's a, what I was calling an embodied viewership, one that's responding, perceiving, or reflecting as part of the completion of the work, or even a completion of an ecosystem, possibly. Thinking about numerous scales simultaneously, the scale of the whole of the machine, the whole of the museum, and the individual discrete parts. So different perceptions of the same world as an active presence, almost like an unstable presence, but to be active within it. And so I asked Tim Morton to come today and speak on the occasion of this exhibition, not only because, of course, I'm a big fan of his work, and not only that his approach to articulating this kind of sharp ecological impasse that I also feel sharply is somehow right on the money, but also as a way to instigate a response as an active viewer and an active thinker and an embodied reflection on the matter at hand. I could almost see that Tim Morton's sentences are part of an ecosystem. They behave like an ecosystem and may actually prove to alter ecosystems. Timothy Morton is the Rita Shea Guffrey Chair in English at Rice University. He has collaborated with artists like Bjork, Chaim Steinbeck, and Olafur Eliasson. He's the author of Ecology Without Nature, which is the first book that introduced me to his work. He's also the author of Realist Magic from 2013, Hyper Objects, Philosophy and Ecology After the End of the World from 2013, and just most recently just came out as Dark Ecology for a Logic of Future Coexistence, as well as almost a dozen other books and a couple hundred other essays on philosophy, ecology, literature, music, art, architecture, design, and of course food. And if you don't already, I encourage you to follow him on his explosive blog, ecologywithoutnature.blogspot.com. And with that, please help me welcome Timothy Morton.
Yeah. Okay.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. I don't need to do any talking now because he's explained it perfectly. So we'll just go to the museum. Actually, I did do a lecture. Sorry to suffer through it. And the title is called Agriculture is Exploding. Thank you for having me, lovely people. It's really nice to see you. Okay. The field had already been opened. A lane a few feet wide had been hand-cut through the wheat along the whole circumference. Pardon? Can't hear me? This needs to be... The field had already been opened. A lane a few feet wide had been hand-cut through the wheat along the whole circumference of the field for the first passage of the horses and machine. Two groups, one of men and lads, the other of women, had come down the lane just at the hour when the shadows of the eastern hedgetop struck the west hedge midway, so that the heads of the groups were enjoying sunrise while their feet were still in the dawn. Presently there arose from within a ticking like the lovemaking of the grasshopper. The machine had begun, and a moving concatenation of three horses and the aforesaid long rickety machine was visible over the... Ooh, what's it going to say on the next page? Gate. Thank you for laughing. Along one side of the field, the whole wain went, the arms of the mechanical reaper revolving slowly. The narrow lane of stubble encompassing the field grew wider with each circuit, and the standing corn was reduced to a smaller area as the morning wore on. Rabbits, hares, snakes, rats, mice, retreated inwards as into a fastness, unaware of the ephemeral nature of their refuge and of the doom that awaited them later in the day when, their covert shrinking to a more and more horrible narrowness, they were huddled together, till the last few yards of upright wheat fell also under the teeth of the unerring reaper, and they were every one put to death by sticks and stones of the harvesters. The reaping machine left the fallen corn behind it in little heaps, each heap being the quantity of the quantity for a sheaf, and upon these the active binders in the rear laid their hands, mainly women, but some of them men. The women were the most interesting of this company of binders, by reason of the charm which is acquired by woman when she becomes part and parcel of outdoor nature. Ooh. A field man is a personality afield. A field woman is a portion of the field. This isn't me, by the way, incidentally. This is Thomas Hardy. I'm not responsible for this. She had somehow lost her own margin and assimilated herself with it. There was one wearing a pale pink jacket. Her binding proceeds with clock-like monotony. From the sheaf last finished, she draws a handful of ears, patting their tips with her left palm to bring them even. Then, stooping low, she moves forward, gathering the corn up with both hands against her knees and pushing her left-gloved hand under the bundle to meet the right on the other side, holding the corn in an embrace like that of a lover. She brings the ends of the bond together and kneels on the sheaf while she ties it, beating back her skirts now and then when lifted by the breeze. A bit of her naked arm is visible, and as the day wears on, its feminine smoothness becomes scarified by the stubble and bleeds. It's the machine age. Yet uncannily, It isn't. It's fields and wheat. Or are the fields already a kind of machine? People appear as machine-like components, legs, clothing, arms and hands, moving. Tess of the D'Urbervilles, a fictional farming girl from 1891, appears as if she were a piece of a gigantic device. Yet she also is a person in her own right, exemplifying a weird contradiction between being and appearing. Seeing this contradiction enabled by the machination of steam engines and Kantian code forces us to think of far, far older machination still churning. A 12,000-year structure, a structure that seems so real, we call it nature. A 12,000-year structure, the slowest and perhaps most effective weapon of mass destruction yet devised. The Anthropocene names two levels we think of as distinct, geology and humanity. Since the late 18th century, humans have been depositing layers of carbon in Earth's crust. In 1945, there occurred the great acceleration of the Anthropocene, marked by a huge data spike in the graph of human involvement in Earth systems. The Anthropocene loops human history and geological time, a strange loop. Consider how personal this can get. There you were, shoveling coal into your steam engine. Remember? Thank you for laughing. It's very good for my ego, so keep doing it, please. That great invention patented in 1784 that Marx hails as the driver of industrial capitalism. The very same machine that Paul Crutzen and Eugene Sturmer hail as the instigator of the Anthropocene. 1784 is not the earliest date for a steam engine patent, but the language of the 1784 patent describes the engine as a general purpose machine that can be connected to any other machine in order to power it, the beginning of the industrial age. There you are, turning the ignition of your car, and it creeps up on you. You are a member of a massively distributed thing. This thing is called species. Yet the difference between the weirdness of my ignition key twist and the weirdness of being a member of the human species is itself weird. Every time I start my car or steam engine, I don't mean to harm Earth, let alone cause the sixth mass extinction event in the 4.5 billion year history of life on this planet. Disturbingly, the most severe the extinction so far in Earth history, the end Permian extinction, was very likely caused also by global warming. Furthermore, I'm not harming Earth. My key turning is statistically meaningless. In an individual sense, this turn isn't weird at all. But go up a level and something very strange happens. When I scale up these actions to include billions of key turnings and billions of coal shovelings, harm to Earth is precisely what is happening. I am responsible as a member of this species for the Anthropocene. Of course, I'm formally responsible to the extent that I understand global warming. That's actually all you need to be responsible for something. You understand this truck is going to hit that man? You are responsible for that man. Yet in this case, formal responsibility is strongly reinforced by causal responsibility. I am the criminal, and I discover this via scientific forensics. Just like in noir fiction, I'm the detective and the criminal. I'm a person. I'm also part of an entity that is now a geophysical force on a planetary scale. The darkness of ecological awareness is the darkness of noir, which is a strange loop. The detective is a criminal. In a strong version of noir, the narrator is implicated in the story, two levels that normally don't cross, that some believe structurally can't cross. We civilized people, we Mesopotamians, are the narrators of our own destiny. Ecological awareness is that moment at which these narrators find out that they are the tragic criminal. And what astonishing reversal, what a twist, or as Aristotle says about tragic downfalls, what a peripeteia, which technically is the moment at which a runner turns around a post in an ancient Greek stadium. A turn, a twist, something weird. What an astounding upsetting of our modern and postmodern fictions about the human and the West. There are so many fictions that enumerating them all would take too long. Just consider the central one having to do with our thoughts about where we live, the planet we inhabit. We've been telling ourselves that homogeneous empty space has conquered localized particular place. Either we are the kind of person who thinks that the category of place is a quaint antique, or we are the kind of person who thinks that the category is worth preserving because it is antique. We are the same kind of person in a certain way. Many have pronounced the death of place since the 1970s. In literary studies, the announcement has gone hand in hand with the language of textuality versus speech. Our habitual talks pit speech, presence, villages, the organic, slow time, traditions, against textuality, disillusioned speed, modern and postmodern techno cultures. Yet the coordinates are terribly out of date. In a twist no one saw coming because we weren't looking outside the human, space has by no means conquered place. That postmodern meme was simply a late symptom of the modern myth of transcending one's material conditions. Exactly the opposite has occurred. From the standpoint of the genuinely post-modern ecological era, which is what I believe we're in now, what has collapsed is the fantasy of empty, smooth space. Space has revealed itself as the convenient fiction of white Western imperialist humans, just as Euclidean geometry has been revealed by relativity theory to be a small, human-flavored region of a much more liquid Gaussian space-time, its straight lines and concepts of space as container good enough to be getting along with if you want to voyage around the coast of Africa and reach the Spice Islands. Space has collapsed and place has emerged in its truly monstrous, uncanny dimension, which is to say, its non-human dimension. How? Now that the globalization dust has settled and the global warming data is in, we humans find ourselves on a very specific planet with a very specific biosphere. It's not Mars, it's planet Earth. Our sense of planet is not a cosmopolitan rush, but rather the uncanny feeling that there are all kinds of places at all kinds of scale. Dinner table, house, street, neighborhood, earth, library, biosphere, ecosystem, city, bioregion, country, tectonic plate. Moreover, and perhaps more significantly, bird's nest, beaver's dam, spider's web, whale migration pathway, wolf territory, bacterial microbiome. And these places, as in the concept of space-time, are inextricably bound up with different types of timescale. Dinner party, family generation, evolution, climate, human world history, unquote, DNA, lifetime, vacation, geology, and again the time of wolves, the time of whales, the time of bacteria. So many interesting places, so many scales, so many non-humans. Place has nothing to do now with good old reliable constancy. What has dissolved is the idea of constant presence. The myth that something is real insofar as it is consistently, constantly there. The concept space was always a constant presencing sort of machine for making things appear consistent and solid, to make them easier to colonize, enslave, and plunder. Constant presence was part of an anthropocentric colonization protocol. The planetary awareness, vaguely imagined by white Western humans in fantasies about spice islands and global trade, is now upon us. And it has nothing to do with the rush of deterritorialization, of finding oneself unbound and unhinged. It's almost the opposite. One finds oneself on the insides of much bigger places than those constituted by humans. Whose place is it anyway? It is space that has turned out to be the anthropocentric concept, now that we're able to think it without a myth of constant presence. Celebrations of deracination and nostalgia for the old ways are both fictional. It's as obvious to any indigenous culture as it is now to anyone with data sets about global warming that these were stories white Westerners were telling themselves, two sides of the same story, in fact. The ecological era is the revenge of place. But it's not your granddaddy's place. This isn't some organic village we find ourselves in, nor indeed a city-state surrounded by fields. Place has a strange loop form because it involves deeply time. Place doesn't stay still, but bends and twists. Place is a twist you can't iron out of the fabric of things. When you are near your destination, you can sometimes feel quite disoriented. You may enhance the magnification on Google Maps to make sure you are really there. The local is far from the totally known or knowable. It's familiar, which also means it's uncanny. German, Heimisch, familiar and unfamiliar, intimate and monstrous at the same time. Nearness doesn't mean obviousness. Just ask someone looking at a dust mite down a scanning electron microscope. When massive entities such as the human species and global warming become thinkable, they grow near. We vaguely sense them out of the corner of our eye while seeing the data in the center of our vision. These hyperobjects remind us that the local is in fact the uncanny. Space evaporates. The nice clean box has melted. We're living on a Gaussian sphere where parallel lines do indeed meet. The empty void of space and the rush of infinity have been unmasked as parochial paradigms. The holism, in which the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, depends upon some false concept of smooth, homogeneous universality, or space, or infinity. And I think one of the wonderful things about what David's done in this piece is to show you precisely this very strange thing that I'm about to say, which is just really odd, but somehow I find it easier on my mind than the normal thing. So let's try. Since they do not fit into the quaint category of space, what hyperobjects reveal to us humans is that the whole is always weirdly less than the sum of its parts. You know, in this museum you've got this combine harvester, right, and it's been taken apart. And, you know, in my kind of philosophy world, everything exists in the same way, right? So, like, if a part of that combine harvester exists, it exists in the same way as the whole combine harvester. So, like, a nut or a rivet is existing just as much as the combine harvester. So it's terribly, terribly simple in my world. The harvester is one, right? And then all the parts are obviously going to be more than one. They exist the same, therefore the whole is less than the sum of its parts, right? Take the new cities springing up, the megacities such as Houston. For architects and urban planners, megacities are hard to conceptualize. Where do they start and stop? Can one even point to them in a straightforward way? And isn't it strange that entities so obviously gigantic and so colossally influential on their surroundings and economies worldwide should be so hard to point to? The fact that we can't point to megacities is deeply because we've been looking in the wrong place for wholes. We keep wondering when the pieces will add up to something much greater. But now that we are truly aware of the global, as in global warming, we know that a megacity is a place among places, that is to say, a finitude that contains all kinds of other finitudes, fragile and contingent, like Doctor Who. Who's seen Doctor Who? British sci-fi. Oh, thank God. Thank goodness for that. And he's got this sort of spaceship, right? And the thing about his spaceship is that, as his companions always say, it's bigger on the inside. That's basically what, in my philosophy, I think about everything, right? You know, grasshopper, stage, Tim. You know, there's more in Tim than there is of Tim. Right? It's pretty obvious. Like, there's more like microbiome DNA than there is Tim DNA, for example. Yeah. All kinds of other finitudes, fragile and contingent, like Doctor Who's TARDIS. It's bigger on the inside than it is on the outside. Places contain multitudes. And this has a retroactive corrosive effect. There never was a constantly present, easy to identify whole, because there never was a general homogeneous space box. When you look back at the earliest city-states, such as Damascus, you end up seeing the same thing as the megacities. And we were talking earlier about sort of rural Indiana and kind of the small towns you encounter there and how you can't really point to where they start or stop. Same thing, yeah? Uncertain boundaries, centers that never quite establish themselves as centers. Why? Is it just a case of historical projection, or is it rather because the city and the city-state are major symptoms of a gigantic elephant in the room? The elephant that eventually caused globalization with its global warming and its ironic byproduct, awareness of global warming. Nature only seems like a given because we use it as a synonym for everything. But really, nature is a normative concept. It tells you how to discriminate between, say, good and bad, natural ingredients versus unnatural. There's a reason why they use that fake language on products. If everything is nature, then nothing can be nature. It's a useless concept. And if nature is normative, then not everything can be nature. Some things have to be unnatural. But this unnaturalness is just something we humans think for whatever reason about whatever it is. Being gay is unnatural according to default homophobia. That's something we're thinking and believing and hardwiring into social space. What we call nature in the largest sense, like mountains and rivers or whatever, is exactly like that. Now the trouble is this kind of nature has also been hardwired into social space. It's not just concept in our heads. We think now of this kind of nature as a nice harmonious periodic cycling. There's a physical reason for that. We started our settled mode of existence, the Neolithic, at the start of the Holocene, which is characterized by nice periodic cycling Earth systems. You know, the carbon cycle, I think. Is he going to say? Oh, good, he says it. The carbon cycle. Who wrote this, by the way? I'm just the guy who reads it, yeah? Cyclones, so don't blame me for anything, yeah? I haven't got a clue what I think or anything like that. The funny thing is, we might have even caused that cycling ourselves through farming and hunting and so on, but even if we didn't, so-called civilization was dangerously coincident with the nice harmonious cycling biosphere that was able therefore to run in the background like a smoothly functioning OS, and thus massively contributed to this idea of humans and their cattle over here, nature over there. Lulled by that myth of smooth functioning, we kept on and on running the logistical program that started in the Fertile Crescent and elsewhere until it required fossil fuels and combine harvesters to keep going. And we know what happens next. So the really extreme way of putting this is, nature is the Anthropocene in its less obvious, seemingly smooth for humans mode. Now can you see why I don't like this concept? There's a default lump ontology going on here. If you go down a level deeper to ontology, which is sort of like, not exactly what exists, which is like science, you know, but like how things exist, right? Nature is what I find when I peel the appearances away. Underneath me, or in my DNA, or underneath the street, or over there in the mountains outside human-built space, is something untouched, something given, as you say. This ontology is directly responsible for the ecological catastrophe in which we now find ourselves. In order to maintain smooth functioning for humans, and to maintain the smooth functioning of this very myth of smooth functioning, a whole lot of violence is required behind the scenes on every level, social, psychic, and philosophical. In every respect, we've been trying to sever ourselves from other life forms. Remember, you have them inside you, and you couldn't exist if you didn't. And there's more of them inside you than there is of you, so this is a major deal, this violence. But this is impossible. For instance, you mention how architecture, herb since about 1900, has been based on vectors of pollution flow. Got to keep the bad air out, for instance, so you need air conditioning. But when you think about things at Earth magnitude, at that scale, where does it go? It doesn't go away, it just goes somewhere else in the system. Nature, if you like, is a sort of fourth wall concept. You know, sort of theatre, like I'm behind it right now, apparently. You know, I came out of, you know. It's why soliloquies are disturbing. So why is Iago so upsetting? Because he keeps looking at the camera and telling you stuff. By which we try to separate the human from everything else. And it functions in house design at every level. So yes, feeling like you're covered in all kinds of spooky stuff as you sit in your flat, that's real ecological awareness, that is. Restructuring or destructuring this logistics is the one thing that would end global warming. But it's usually considered out of bounds because it implies accepting a non-modern view, a view established on, although it thinks itself as a further disenchantment of, now ancient and previously violent monotheisms, which in turn find their origin in the privatization of enchantment in the Neolithic with its civilization. We're still Mesopotamians. Now that is a contemporary weird slip of the tongue. Mesopotamia, that is awesome. Somebody remember that, please. Please remember that. Awesome. I took too much meth, I keep forgetting. We are Neolithic humans confronting the disaster of the Neolithic fantasy of smoothly functioning agricultural logistics has wrought, and we want to hold on to the philosophical there underpinnings of these logistics for dear life. An agricultural person, aka us, realizing that she is in a twisted historical or ethical or philosophical space, experiences what is called tragedy, which is an agricultural age way of computing the damage caused by an agricultural age. OMG. I'm caught in a twisted loop in which my attempt to escape the web of fate has been but a further entwining of that web. Tragedy supposes that looping is evil, and that despite the fact that you can't escape fate, especially when you try, there is this forlorn hope that in the end, or in some better world over yonder that we can never reach, we might be able to slip those bonds once and for all and smooth everything out. Hence the ultimately religious horizon of tragedy, where, for instance, the chorus tells you that there's nothing here that is not Zeus. That's Euripides' play Heracles. But from another point of view, called comedy, this OMG quality is kind of LOL. Tragedy is in fact a small region of comedy space, which is twisted all the way through. Right now, ecological awareness presents itself as tragedy, but sooner or later we will start to smile. And you know, that's the other thing about the museum, right? You're looking at this incredibly violent, in a way, machine. You come in and the first thing that strikes you is this immense machination sound. It's a very, very intense video, but there's something funny about it as well, you know? And it's sort of like, David, sort of somehow he's helping us to smile about that, and I think that's very, very, very important. Sooner or later we'll start to smile, which is maybe how we get to cry for real. Since there is no beyond in which things are indeed totally straight, totally untwisted, it's funny to watch someone acting as if there was such a beyond and constantly slipping into the web of fate like a slapstick character whose attempt to get from A to B keeps being hampered by his very style of trying to get from A to B. In the end, this is why art, which disables getting from A to B, for instance by dismantling a combine harvester, by causing the illusion of smooth functioning to malfunction so as to reveal the spooky openness of things, is in the end joyful and funny, though we need to traverse and respect and not delete a realm of exquisite pain to get there. Going one level deeper, does anything ever function smoothly at all? Consider what is now called, in my world, thing theory. Thing theory relies on Heidegger's tool analysis. So this is basically what this guy's saying. Yeah? When a tool breaks or malfunctions, we notice it. This theory of malfunctioning points out that when things smoothly function, when they just happen, they withdraw from access. Right, so like you're not noticing that you're wearing clothes, according to this right now. You listen to this, you want to get to the reception, all that kind of stuff, right? When your computer breaks, you notice you have a computer. You know, that kind of thing. Right, OMG. When I am involved in a task, the things I involve myself with disappear. Paradoxically, the inverse of thing theory is not nothing at all, but what I shall now call object theory, which is basically what I do. I here use this term object in the sense described by object-oriented ontology. Now, you have to kind of get behind this idea that sort of like, when I say object, I don't mean like lump of bleh. That's the whole idea, right? It's sort of like the lump of bleh idea of objects has been like really messing things up. So if the word object does that to you, because like you see the word and it's like a mirror for what you think things are, yeah? So like substitute some other word that doesn't suck, like entity, right? If object doesn't work. It turns out that malfunctioning tools that we notice all of a sudden depend not only on a smoothly functioning without our attention, but also on a far deeper being that is strictly inaccessible no matter how deeply we probe or how deeply anything probes, including the tool in question. And tool kind of very, very generally put, you know, like the floor is the tool for my feet, and the lectern is the tool for the floor, and the leg bone's connected to the arm bone, and the arm bone's connected to the city bone, and the city bone's connected to the toxic waste dump bone, and the toxic waste dump bone's connected to the biosphere bone, and the biosphere bone's connected to the earth bone, and the earth bone's connected to the hummingbird bone, and the hummingbird bone's connected to the Amazon basin bone, and the Amazon basin bone's connected to the solar system bone, you know. And I'm in a hell of a mess. So like everything, yeah? When I say tool, like everything. But perhaps deeper is not quite the right term. Let's try this on for size. Objects are so incredibly themselves, yet in this self-sameness they are weird, self-transcending. The contrary motion of what things are and how they appear jets out of a thing. Right? So according to this, there's a fundamental difference between what things are and how they appear. Nevertheless, how they appear is exactly like an index, as David was saying, of what they are. Like raindrops are wet and splashy. They're not sweet and gumdroppy, unfortunately, sometimes. Right, but on the other hand, this wet splashiness is just like raindrop data. It's not actual raindrops. So you're never going to get the actual raindrop. Right? This is the idea that totally freaked out Kant. And since then, everyone else, like in philosophy world, has been trying to like put that idea back in the box. Because in the end, it means that like Yoda is more correct than Kant. And we're all like being like modern philosophy. I'm not Yoda. I really am not. I'm not an animistic Yoda person who believes in this universal force. You know, really, it's really literally that. If you've got 5 hours, I'll prove it. Things emit uniqueness. They bristle with specificity. Purple, pale violet, light blue. Their soft and sharp spines and flower spines bristle forth. Bristle forth despite me, despite my subject-object schisms. Stones are the kinds of being who, I should be saying that, definitely don't have worlds, according to Heidegger. Humans, and by extension extraterrestrials, have worlds. Animals, unquote, are poor in world, and stones have no world whatsoever, right? So, you know, you've got the world of the library and the world of having to listen to boring Tim, and like the world of your life and the world of that. And that, says Heidegger, is because you're a human. And in particular, German humans are the best at that, which is why they should be controlling everything, right? So the completely, like, irrelevant bit of his philosophy, by the way, the way to denazify him is to, like, go straight in there, like into HAL 9000, and just take that bit out, right? Because it doesn't work, really. Like, according to, on his own terms, it doesn't work. Yeah? Stones are just part of the stage set. The stage set is produced, so you've got to get rid of them with the combine harvesters. Process that stands. The stage set is produced by thought, insofar as humans are sentient and cunning and uncannily good at inventing tech. Unlike lizards or amethysts, this is the myth, right? You know, like digging sticks and stuff. What a strange thing for Heidegger to cleave to when you think about it. Heidegger is a profound critic of the idea that thought is the one true or best access mode, the only stage setter in town, tumbling stones to polish them, putting them in a Zen garden, or indeed heaving them into a circle are also equally legitimate access modes, which is to say worlding modes. The temporal tumbling of Dasein, which is what he calls like us, you know, he's trying to think of a word for it that doesn't automatically like spell it out like human or whatever. The temporal tumbling of Dasein gathers the stones and it's snowballing, slinky-like, flopping around and around like a rolling stone. Nothing about thought makes it the privileged way in which this gathering occurs. Indeed, the Heidegger of the tool analysis, the Heidegger of the first division of being and time, wants to say that believing that thought is the top access mode has no good reason for it, apart from Neoplatonic Christian prejudices that also involve thought, reified into soul, and sitting in some command module, somewhere inside the human body, a gas in a bottle. Right, so like, you know, ploughing is an access mode, yeah? Such thinking has recently been called by a prominent Heideggerian epistemism. But as we have very briefly seen, Heidegger's very concept of world, the orchestration of things into meaningfulness, depends upon an idea of human-style thought as a special access mode that is illegal in Heidegger. This kind of anthropocentrism is definitely then a bug in the Heideggerian system, and the Nazism that follows from it, humans are the best worlders and German humans are the best of the best, must therefore also be a bug, not a feature of Heideggerianism, which in turn means, though we haven't shown the mechanism exactly how, this doesn't very matter very much right now, that humans cannot be the only entities in the worlding business. What we have seen about entity junctions is enough to allow anything in the world to be in the worlding business, as a matter of fact. This is because the uncertain sliding of past over future, implied in this Dasein slinky movement, is exactly the lopsided slinky-like flopping about of Dasein, its ecstatic out-of-joint quality. This implies that Heidegger only works if everything has Dasein. Everything is lopsided. Nothing can be a perfectly smooth component in a perfectly smoothly functioning world. Indeed, the idea that worlds are beautifully sealed, self-contained, smooth things, like Wittgenstein's house, has to go. And furthermore, the smooth functioning of smooth functioning as such, as I was saying, has to go, because this really is just an outcome of the persistent functioning of a certain temporality architecture, namely the Mesopotamian style, one that has successfully been churning away like a software application in the background for about 12,500 years, giving rise eventually to the need for fossil fuels, hence industry, hence global warming and mass extinction. The smooth functioning of this human-scaled world has often been called nature, and it has blinded thinkers such as Heidegger to the possible existence of actual aliens, terrestrial rather than extraterrestrial, not thought-heavy, big-headed versions of ourselves either. Furthermore, there's nothing that special about sentience, let alone thought. You don't have to be cognizant of your hammer while you're putting up a picture, Heidegger's kind of example. In fact, you pretty much can't be. The hammer breaks or malfunctions in some other way, and there you are, cognizant of it. So Heidegger's own term, sentience, isn't a special access mode either. Worlds look like they might be a lot cheaper than the smuggled-in Neoplatonic contraband amplified by default Aristotelian categorization, animal, vegetable, mineral, makes them appear. And the whole point of this is, of course, that the human world and the non-human world are completely intersecting, right? And like, we have worlds, but worlds are, like, really super perforated, right? And the problem is we've been acting like they're not. That's the problem, yeah? There are two ways of proceeding further. One would be to chuck out the Heidegger and whatever other continental philosophy was bugging us and try some other method which might look at first good but would end up putting us back where we started. The other, which Heidegger invented, is called deconstruction, is to find the solution within the problem itself, which in this case is what I would call the correlationist lineage, and in particular its specific Heideggerian incarnation. Let's do it that way. So correlationism, what does it mean? It means like there is that things are real, but you can't really like access them until you've like handled them in some way, until you have related to them in some way. It's like there is a light in the refrigerator, but you can't like know that until you've opened the fridge, right? Now, there's one way of like dealing with this, which is to chuck the idea out, right? It's like modern philosophy idea, yeah? The older idea is that there really are things and they're like atoms or whatever, they're made of bits, yeah? So you could get rid of it and go back to that. Or you could sort of say, well, maybe the problem is not that idea, it's the anthropocentric copyright control on that idea. Maybe everything can be like a fridge opener, you know, like stones can be a fridge openers and lizards can be fridge openers, yeah? Worlds don't function smoothly because smooth functioning is an anthropocentric Mesopotamian myth filtered in Heidegger through the kind of medieval ontology that he detects has been illegally smuggled into Descartes and subsequently into Kant. Heidegger was obviously not totally over the Jesuit training from which he had extricated himself. Thinking souls inside bodies like Martians in their metal pods in H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds are not totally in charge of everything, and as a result, the idea that worlds function smoothly and that smooth functioning is something to aim at are revealed to be optical illusions. Worlds are tattered. They are riddled with broken bits. They are perforated, which is to say that all kinds of other worlds can permeate and penetrate them, which is how things can actually work. So when you go in the museum, you'll see like trillions of world parts of this world machine called the Combine Harvester, right? And these parts sort of intersect with all kinds of other worlds, like art gallery space or biosphere space or blades of grass or something like, or you walking around it, yeah? If there really were just one kind of smooth, true world, a human-scaled one, then malfunctions become a big deal and reveal in the negative how being isn't presence. Fair enough, we know that already. But how also this non-presence just churns away in the background like a reliable operating system? Not good at all, just a projection of anthropocentric scaling. That kind of non-presence depends upon a much more profound non-presence that is exactly how things are, despite being correlated to some decider. Weak correlationism, right, which is sort of like, instead of thinking, because I'm the fridge opener, there really isn't a fridge at all. Like, you know, like most kind of contemporary philosophy ends up with George Bush. Do you remember, like, the second worst press conference he ever did? So I'm the decider, you know, I get to decide what goes down, right? And then the worst press conference ever in 2005, if anyone remembers, it's the worst thing I ever heard on the telly. In America, was his spokesperson right at the height of the Iraq war, hubris, and he's going, we create realities. And your job is, as journalists, is to study them. And you'll study them, as you will. But by the time you finish studying them, we will have created another reality for you to study. It's like, wow, that's pretty chilling. You know, so like a lot of philosophy is like that, humans create reality, yeah? Just ask like a chimp how that's been working out so far. Weak correlationism, in which you're not completely making reality, you're just like, you can't like get at the light in the fridge completely, allows us to flip Kant upside down and argue for the powers of things in themselves, not considered as mathematizable extensional blank screens, as Kant does, also smuggling the anthropocentric containment systems into his actually rather explosive thought. Weak correlationism allows us to imagine other worlding orchestration modes and to imagine how these modes can interlock with ours, must interlock with ours for things to happen at all. A huge cave of fossils and crystals and stalactites and stalagmites glittering as their pasts and futures slide over one another is found when we break open the smooth-seeming Heideggerian surface of anthropocentrically scaled functioning. Theoretically, then, there's nothing stopping stones from having worlds, and this possibility is what makes Heidegger true! Exclamation mark. The notion of world is cheaper than it's cracked up to be. Heidegger makes it too expensive for anyone but humans, and mostly German humans at that. If world is in fact quite a lot cheaper than that because worlds are perforated and tattered, incomplete and accessible by other world orchestrations, then stones have worlds and worlding doesn't make things real, it simply creates networks of entities. And networks of entities can overlap such that one can be a node in two or three or more crisscrossing networks. Because things are inherently broken, in other words, because they never coincide with themselves at any spatial or temporal point, the worlds that emerge from their never smooth orchestrations are necessarily tattered. And for the same reason, because they're riddled with gaps between what they are and how they appear, being and appearing, entities and thus the world they construct are intrinsically perforated. Of course, we can know what it's like to be a lion, at least up to a point. This is sort of Wittgenstein's thing. He had a very smooth house, and he had a very smooth idea that you couldn't ever like imagine what it would be like to be a lion. But like what happened last year with Cecil the Lion was kind of like above and beyond animal rights. It was like a whole bunch of people feeling so beaten down they realized they had more in common with the lion than with the dentist, don't you think? Agri-logistics, as I call it, this is like, agri-logistics is the logistical program that results in like the combine harvester, yeah? Is precisely a severing of human non-human ties such that we confront a seemingly smoothly functioning world. Even Heidegger himself thinks that this smooth functioning is itself smoothly functioning. It's why you need object-oriented ontology, which is my thing, to go one level deeper into the realm of entities that are never exhausted by access at all. Not that they last forever, but that they are mysterious or open or unspeakable in some sense. Our smoothly functioning world is now malfunctioning precisely because of this gap between our world with its anthropocentric access modes and actual reality. And this is the really crazy part, there we are, woven into the coral reef of actual entities underneath the smoothly gliding submarine of human civilization. We are one of those unspeakable entities. We, as the human species, not as in some racist or speciesist fantasy, which is precisely invented to allow us to believe we can point to what a human being is to distinguish the human from the non-human or the inhuman in some rigid way. The gap between the human world and the human species is exactly the cause of a kind of weird spectrality. Our world is now malfunctioning sufficiently for us to begin to glimpse the darker, weirder malfunctioning, the sinister kind of mal that might even be intrinsic to functioning, aka causality, as such. Spectrality, in a way, is the mal of this functioning. Not just a superficial appearance, but exactly the sound of extinction faintly audible behind the din of the motor cars, its incredible weakness, a horrible symptom of its colossal power. But at my back, in a cold blast, I hear the rattle of the bones and chuckle spread from ear to ear. And Eliot nails it, Anthropocene-wise, when he repeats with a difference, but at my back, from time to time, I hear the sound of horns and motors. Eliot, poet of the spectral, poet of the kinds of visitation you get while walking at altitude. Who is the third who walks always beside you? Who is the third who walks always beside you? When I count, there are only you and I together, but when I look up ahead the white road, there is always another one, walking beside you, gliding, wrapped in a brown mantle, hooded, I do not know whether a man or a woman. But who is that on the other side of you? And us lot, the humans, the art historians, the literary scholars, the music scholars, the philosophers, the historians, we could start to get the hang of this. We know this. We know what it is. We've been studying it for years, just exactly and precisely this. To do speculative realism, which is sort of what I do, to do ecological criticism, which is also sort of what I do, you so don't have to jump to some incredibly different domain with incredibly different vocabulary. You can use what you have. You just need to relax that anthropocentric reference frame, which is equivalent to wanting to be haunted, right? You sort of want to be haunted by non-human beings. Just like you don't have to completely remove the boron rods from a nuclear reactor for something interesting to happen. You just have to let a little bit of the explosion we've been trying to contain happen, the explosion we've been trying to contain for about two centuries, as long as the Anthropocene so far. Because back in the later 18th century, as I was saying, suddenly Western human beings discovered the possibilities of Yoda. You know, and like a lot of us have been like trying to hit delete on that for the last 200 years. But unfortunately, David Brooks came along and he's could have re-churned it up again. So it really shouldn't be surprising then to humanist scholars that to see data patterns about entities such as extinction at the right ontological level, you also need to look at spectres, because it's actually very hard to find extinction. You have to look at like ghost traces of it. Like how you know, if you study poetry, that the processes operating on you, the reader, are hiding in plain sight, right there in the flickering of language. How you know to detect irony in these aesthetic exploitation of gaps between different levels of signification. How Derrida trained you to see the unseeable play of difference. When object-oriented ontologists talk about withdrawal, like objects withdraw from access, that doesn't mean they empirically shrink back behind something. They mean, and this is why I now prefer to say open instead of withdrawn, they mean so in your face that you can't see it. We can do this. We can do this. We're not totally crushed. We can start to dream the Anthropocene in a non-PTSD way. We can even enjoy the spookiness of feeling our way around inside it, like Sally Sparrow in that gothic mansion in Doctor Who. And now I know that you can think about that. We've been training for years. As Sally herself says quite succinctly in a single phrase unwittingly summing up decades of melancholia, activation modes such as queer theory, with its encrypted desires, detectings of racist structure and the iambic pentameter, Frankfurt School critique with its Hegel in a Beckett play, cul-de-sacs, deconstruction, French and biocentric feminisms naming and jamming the death culture machinery, convoluted Benjaminian paranoia, and good old romantic irony and noir, quote, sad is happy for deep people. Thank you. Normal old new leftist, see, you're all deep, yeah? Normal old new leftist scholars of the world, unite! You have nothing to lose but your anthropocentrism. Come on in, the water's lovely, which is to say it's cold and dark and mysterious and spooky. Sad, reaching back to a pre-agricultural mode of conscious coexistence with non-humans. That truly is happy for deep people, with all the irony that entails. David Brooks's labels show you the biosphere and all of it. But something has malfunctioned. Instead of pointing at the art, the labels point at the context that the art materials are doing a fantastic 12,500-year job of destroying. The art is a breaking of a machine that is part of the logistical... Help! I'm concluding and I can't turn the page. Part of the logistical machinery, social, psychic, philosophical, that broke the biosphere. The malfunctioning of a malfunction. Now, two malfunctions don't make a function. The art knows it's not saving Earth, nor is it about saving Earth. It's about attuning to the beings nearly silenced in our social, psychic, and philosophical space, the beings ploughed up by the agri-logistics, the non-humans present as spectres, which uncannily is precisely a true dimension of what they are. Thank you. Now, apparently what's going to happen next is that me and David are going to, like, sit here. Is that right? We sort of sit here and talk and take questions and stuff? Is that what we're going to... Yeah. We're going to do that? So, like, get me a chair, David. Thank you. Okay, and, like, maybe we can share the mic or something, yeah?
Sure.
Do you like this angle?
I think it's good.
It's good, yeah?
Yeah.
90-ish degrees, like, you know.
Let's do a perfect...
I see you.
Let's do a 45.
Yeah, there you go. 45,
okay.
There
yeah.
You see.
Okay.
I see
there.
You.
Yeah.
Okay. Hello.
Well, I could... Can go I on, start with, first with a question? And then,
yeah. Oh, dear, yes.
This is something I've been thinking about, and you started to visit it a little bit when you said, I'm driving the truck, therefore I'm responsible for that man I'm about to hit. Mm-hmm. Right? And so this might just be a fiction I created in my head, but there's something about the object-oriented ontology view and how you are approaching it that I think reinstills or almost forces a responsibility in a different kind of way back into the perceiver.
Cheers, mate. No one said that yet. I thought the sentence was going to go the other way, which is like, you think stones are just as important as humans, so you didn't think humans are important, so you don't believe in ethics, so we can murder people. But actually, that's not what you're saying.
Right, no.
You're saying the other one, which is awesome. What you're saying is, you're now totally free to have any kind of affiliation with anything you want, right? And you've got the controls, unfortunately, and it's up to you to, like, create a nice world. It's always going to be a little bit incomplete and perforated. So, like, we'll get together with this polar bear and that cloud and this library and these art materials, and we'll make a nice little reading group, and we'll talk about stuff, and it'll be like a really boring, long, anarchistic kind of discussion about something. And then eventually it'll inevitably dissolve, you know, and sort of that's it, right? That's it. Like, you've got the controls to make thousands of little different social structures all the time. Mm. Is that kind of like what
you're... Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Wow. No one said that yet. Cheers, mate. You just saved all these guys like a whole hour of Tim.
All right, we're done. Thanks, everybody. Yeah.
Once that the difference between the Judeo-Christian cultures and Aboriginal cultures is that we were the only ones who believed that we got kicked out of paradise to begin with, and they never thought they left.
Right.
Therefore, they've always had a different collaboration, if you will, where we could abuse something because we thought it was somehow separate from us.
Right on, totally.
To both of you guys, what do you have to say about
that? May
those?
May I?
Yeah.
Oh, look, I've got my own now. Both those things are part of the same thing. That's genius, actually. Because what they're part of is this idea we've been telling ourselves for about, I think, 12,000 years, which is the whole is always greater than the sum of its parts. This is nothing but a monotheism tweet, right? Like, there's this huge, great, transcendental being. Usually he's a bit evil because he wants to kill you or get rid of you in some way. And he's definitely not you, and he's over there somewhere, and sort of he contains... And it's a he, mostly. And he contains the universe. But even when it's a she, as Irigaray points out, there's a problem, yeah? Like, he is the universe, but bigger than the universe somehow, right? Now, this is a big problem. It affects every single thing that we like to think. Like, it affects Marxist philosophy. Like, you have enough machines making enough other machines, and then all of a sudden, poof, there you get capitalism. Or like the fashionable idea of emergence. You have enough little electrons go ba 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 ba. Poof, the kettle's boiling, wow, you know, sort of like that, right? All these ideas have got a bug, and this is like a monotheism bug, right? And if we don't want to have the monotheism, because it's basically a way of supporting this agri-logistical destruction mode, right, then we have to do this other thing, right? We have to, like, drop that. And so profoundly, we have to get behind this idea that the whole is actually less than the sum of its parts, and that's actually beautifully demonstrated by holograms, right? Because I'm fascinated by this. When you cut a little, you know this? When you cut a little piece of a hologram of a rose, what you get is the complete rose, right? So, like, potentially, I don't know, like, does it go down to the Planck length? I don't know, but potentially there's an infinity of, like, roses in that rose, right? Like, there's so much more roseness in the rose than just that hologram rose. That's actually a really beautiful way of thinking about it. Right, like it's sort of holographic. Objects are like, oh, thank you. Wow, Mesopotamians and holographic objects.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Yeah.
Right, that's cool, yeah?
Ditto.
Just to add to that, is it possible that the god, the mono, could be the hologram where it gave each one of us a piece? So, you know, the lizard kingdom's got their pieces, and the human kingdom's got their pieces.
No, I think that's a little bit slipping a bit towards the gargantua of the idea of the whole is bigger, right? We can't see this bigger whole, so we have a problem. That's like a fall myth, a little bit, right? Like, a better way would be, like, you know, the lizard is my sister, yeah? And this lizard is my sister precisely because this lizard is haunted by itself. Like, it never totally coincides with itself, right? Like, maybe it has this weird genetic superpower of being able to, like, fly or something, because it's a, you know, it could be a bird. You know, like, fish, some fish can breathe out of water for a few seconds. You know, so, like, every species in evolution is, like, itself and, like, a little bit not itself at the same time. Just biologically, that's true, right? But also, of course, spirit animal, true, yeah? So instead of thinking about soul as being, like, in your body, it's much more like in the Golden Compass, his Dark Materials thing, where you've got these little sort of non-human spectre-like, what are they called there? Sort of sitting on your shoulder, yeah, thank you, yeah? And they're sort of you, but they're sort of not, right? And so it's much closer to a kind of animistic picture of the world where everything is like got a kind of ghosty, spirity part of itself, yeah?
You have this analogy I've heard you say before, the notion of the fish tank. Of which might be kind of an appropriate analogy also here, but which is it a delusional sense of reality, or is it like how to perceive? Again, this comes back to this notion of perception, which for visual artists, or for me, is like really fascinating. But maybe if you could impart the fish tank analogy.
Yeah, sure. It's not a
or the fish bowl. Sorry.
Right. I'm not trying to argue that we're deluded in a way. I'm trying to in a way that's the only way we can have reality. Right, there's a difference, I think, between real and reality, right? Real is something you can never point to or touch, right? But it's real nonetheless, right? You know, like this Irish woman said to me once, you know, sure, I don't believe in the fairies, but they're all the same. You know, like that, right? Reality, the itty bit, which is like nurse or unce or something like that, reality nurse, realness, like the feeling that it's real, yeah, is what happens to us seeing the world through our inevitably anthropomorphic fishbowl. Now, when I say anthropomorphic, what I mean is not some thought in your head, but just the fact that whatever this is, let's call it anthropo something for now, whenever it holds a microphone, it's anthropomorphizing it. The hand is anthropomorphizing the mic, right? So we're kind of like in that fishbowl, and actually kind of that sanity, you know. Like my brother has schizophrenia, and like the going theory of schizophrenia, which I don't doubt because I sort of observed it in my brother, is that something like there comes like a crack in the fishbowl, right? And you very very like the hallucination is a way to like seal the crack, right? Actually, it's called the schizophrenic defense for a reason, right? The hearing voices hallucinating are ways of actually maintaining the fishbowl, actually. So this fishbowl isn't a bad fishbowl. And the other cool thing is, while I'm anthropomorphizing the mic is mic-morphizing my hand, right, according to this, right? And like the shoes are shoe-morphizing my feet, which is a shame because they're a bit too small. And like the carpet is carpet-morphizing my eyes, and you know, lizards are lizard-morphizing my speech just by being in this sentence, and so on and so on, right? And so, like, there's no problem with this morphizing thing. All we have to do is realize that mics and lizards and carpets also have fishbowls. Yeah, and actually, maybe a better, from a certain point of view, would be our fishbowl for a long time has been a combine harvester. We've been looking at the world from inside the glass cab of a combine harvester, wondering how we can plow it up best to suit what we want, right? And like treating it like a blank sheet for like desire projection purposes, right? But it's not a blank sheet, right? It's like stones and grass and trees and water, like it's actual discrete, specific, sparkly things, right? And so this whole kind of blank sheet thing is a bit of a problem, yeah?
Mm-hmm. So if the fish tank is this cab of the combine,
I'm not running away.
No, it's okay. How does the fish tank, or how does this the driver of the fish tank, the fish bowl?
Would you like some water?
I'm okay, yeah? Thank you. Yeah. And we're speaking, of course, analogously, historically here, but there's a rear view mirror problem of kind of an impossibility of acknowledging this. And this is what I get to this notion of the ethics of this, what I asked earlier on about the responsibility of the person, this ability to see the perceiver. To be able to see this differently, and so this is kind of the rear view mirror of the fishbowl idea.
You don't need to see anything differently, because from my point of view.
Can I
sure, go.
Timothy, you always have this thing about the objects seem closer.
Hey, thanks. I do. Yeah. Hello. Yeah, no, I was just about to go there because, like. There's a whole way in which, like, there's so much less of a problem than we think, and that is the problem, especially for intellectual people. They want there to be a huge, big problem that's almost insoluble. Not you, but, like, a lot of people in my world are, like, performing, I'm more intelligent than you, because I can see the problem is much worse than you think it is. It's much bigger and badder and bigger, and, like, oh, what's this idea reminding you of? My problem's bigger than your problem. You know, kind of thing. You know, and sort of like, it's called cynical reason, you know, and it's like how we've been pretending to be right for the last couple of hundred years, and like, it so doesn't work, plus it's also very, like, violent, you know. And so sort of, in a funny way, there's much less of a problem, there has to be much less of a problem, right? The thing is that these beings, these non-human beings, they're right here, right now. You know, like I'm writing this book for Penguin, and it's called Being Ecological, like being John Malkovich, right? And it's for Jane Doe walking through Sydney Airport, and Jane Doe sees the book and she goes, do you know what, I'm not going to buy those dumplings, I'm going to buy this book, right? So who's that? That's somebody who doesn't care at all about ecology, you know, because basically I'm a bit fed up of like this preachy mode in which also we're retweeting this monotheism about with ecological language. If only you could just believe, or in your words, perceive differently, everything would be, No. Plus also, by now we've hoovered up all of those people who get into that language. What about the other people who don't care? You know, so I'm setting the bar super, super low, and I'm actually not even stealth preaching. Do you see what I'm saying? What I'm saying is, are you wearing clothes? You are actually now relating to a non-human being, right? Like, do you use bleach? You know, I mean, it's like super, super, super low. Like, do you have a cat? Yes. Do you like to stroke your cat? Yes. You're relating to another non-human being in a non-coercive, non-violent mode of coexistence, right? It's not a problem. It's so much less of a problem because, thank you so much for pointing this out, there's an ontological reason why. That has to do with the deep structure of being rather than like something that you ate for breakfast or the political state of whatever, right? It's because, as was just said, objects in mirror, the mirror of your car is more like optimistic than you are, and it's also deep, deep, deep philosopher, your car mirror, because it says objects in mirror are closer than they appear, right? Which is also a little bit what they say in mysticism, like as a way of like slightly containing the kind of Yoda aborigine space. Religions have got these VIP lounges called mysticism. And when you qualify and you've been done in enough by the religion, you get to go in the VIP lounge, and the guy in the VIP lounge says, you know what, all this stuff about God and all that stuff, it's not really true. And you are it, whatever that is. And what you have to do is just sort of like tune into it. You know, that's a little tiny, slightly distorted piece of a pre-agricultural way of being in this, like, contained, like a sort of taboo thing contained in this VIP lounge thing, right? And, like, according to this, whatever that God thing is, it's not over there, it's in here, it's super, super close. That's why you can't see it, because it's actually, it's not just in your face, it is your face, yeah? So this is sort of, like, coincident with this object idea, like, that things are super, super, super near, phenomenologically near, right? Like, think about the black hole at the center of the Milky Way. So the black hole at the center of the Milky Way is now here, in a phenomenological sense. It's near. It's right here. We're talking about it. Yeah? Right? So these things that we can't see or touch are also super, super, super close. So there's not a problem that we can't see or touch them. The problem is that we think that we need to see or touch them to make them close. Right? I need to plow this field to make it be my field that I'm plowing for my human being project. You know, I can't just like let things just be. Yeah, kind of, roughly. You know, like, I'm not saying don't plow stuff and just like lie around feeling weird. You know, obviously, like, people have got agricultural systems. They just don't have to have such a violent one size fits all, one agricultural system to rule them all mode. That's all. Easy. Yeah.
Weekend on a farm with a lot of animals, and I think had an experience with them which illustrates a little bit of this exchange, which was that it happened to be a farm attached to a fiber mill where animals were being sheared for fiber but not being killed, and I had this amazing sensation of all the animals being incredibly interested in my presence, and happened to have an afternoon to spend with them, and realized just how much they were perceiving us. And that made all the difference. It really gave me a totally different experience of myself as an animal in their company. And I think that it also kind of extended itself to the entire ecosystem of that farm. Where everything felt incredibly, that there was this real receptivity and perception happening on both sides of it.
Is it not, at least in my experience, super, super healing to be seen?
Yeah.
Right? And therefore, is it not super, super distressing that we've been pretending for thousands of years that these beings don't see us, that they're not even part of us, we're suddenly not part of them? And we've been going, no, just like blank, whatever. And we got to this point where you have to like prove that like a chimp is a person before you can like liberate it from a zoo or whatever. And it's sort of like, you know, you're sort of like setting the bar super high and you'll never, ever, ever prove, because I can't even prove I'm a person.
Right, and it's also, what an interesting thing is that in some way taking care of animals has always seemed slightly mysterious. Like, when do you know, what should you do?
Right on.
And there was something so clear about the fact that these animals were taking care of themselves.
Yeah.
And sort of putting up with what the humans were doing with
yeah.
them, more than being aided in any way
yeah.
to continue what they were doing.
Yeah, and sort of putting up with could also be a care mode. You know, like care is kind of like a default. Like, you know, like I'm lifting up this glass because I care somehow. But maybe the glass also cares. I don't know, I'm not a glass, I can't tell. But like, since it's just the case that I can't prove that I'm a person, then I might as well just allow the glass as well as the pig, you know, to kind of be that a little bit. You know, why not? What the hell? You know, it's deeply healing to think that way, you know. And I like that idea, you know, being seen, yeah. Yeah.
And how does that, how are you comparing
okay.
philosophy to yoga?
Ooh. All right. So, in the Enlightenment period in Europe and America, religion slightly broke for some people, like a bottle. And out of this bottle came a liquid. And this liquid was called, by some people, animal magnetism. And this guy called Mesmer thought that that was what it was. And this animal magnetism was an all-pervasive universal force that surrounds and penetrates life forms created by life. And that's pretty much what Yoda says. Right? Now, Kant was fascinated by animal magnetism. And yet, in his prose, he totally disavows it. And he, like, critiques it and doesn't want to talk about it. But funnily enough, it's the only way that his philosophy actually works. Because in order for things to... for you to know that there's this thing happening that makes things real, you have to know that there's this experience called beauty. And in the experience called beauty, you're basically having a totally non-coercive mind meld with something that might not be even sentient, aka a painting like the Mona Lisa, right? And in that experience, you can't actually tell whether the Mona Lisa's doing it to you or you're doing it to the Mona Lisa, right? So there's a tiny, tiny bit of this kind of animal magnetism space in which basically I can influence you non-locally, right? Like there's this force, so I can the emperor, I can just sort of do things to you without touching you, right? That's the idea, yeah? And, you know, it's this completely non-mechanical causality theory, which is awesome because causality isn't mechanical, as we now know from quantum theory, which is the most consistent way of explaining stuff, right? Because, mechanical, like, the idea that there's something has to push something else in order for it to move, basically. Like, and like also this is a monotheism thing, because then again there has to be some prime thing that does the pushing. Only one thing's allowed to be moving all by itself, and that's basically God or the universe or whatever, and that pushes stuff, right? There's like the process philosophy version where it's just the universe pushing, and we're like byproducts of that, right? But it's the same kind of problem. There's just only one pusher, really, you know. But instead, it's the case that everything is kind of shimmering. Everything's moving all by itself, right? And so, you know, very, very quickly, you get into this kind of Yoda space where there's this, you know, universal non-local energy field that you can, you know, and this is like woo-woo. Like, university professors like me shouldn't be saying that. That's what we shouldn't be saying, right? Like, you can say mindfulness now in the university and not get fired, but you can't say prana. Right, you can't say nadi, you can't say bindu, and you certainly can't say force, the force. You really can't say that. Like, even nadi, prana, and bindu are like ways of containing the force, right? But I think this force thing, like, why is even Star Wars popular? You know, why is it even like a thing? Like, why is it a $1 billion massive, great big franchise thing, you know, that we go and watch? You know, I think it's this force thing, yeah? Which has the shortest answer?
Well, the short one is a yes or no answer.
Ooh.
Are you going to publish the text of the talk you gave today in any way? Because it was just so rich.
That's very nice of you. I haven't thought about that yet. I tend to do talks like from the future. Like, I don't think, like, why would you want to say something that you already knew? So I'm not totally in control of everything I'm saying. And so, like, I don't really know, actually. I don't know.
Okay.
You know?
Well, maybe you'll say you don't know.
Yeah.
This is a longer question. One thing that I think is common to what you were saying and continued service culture daily is the idea of a collision of paradoxical systems. So, you know, in the case of the combine, it's obvious because you have the ecosystem that has its own rules or way of existing. And then you have this combine, which is the sequential and hierarchical and taxonomical system. And the ecosystem is not necessarily sequential, hierarchical, or taxonomical. And when you have the two of them collide, there's a friction and a violence to the difference in the way that those two systems work. And I think maybe what we've been talking about, the idea of consciousness and perception, the way that we build consciousness and perception in many ways up till now has been very sequential and hierarchical and taxonomical, and that might not be the most effective way to engage with a true ontological system. So in the context of this, I was thinking, when you said quantum theory, and the idea of the whole being less than the parts, what is the system that the quantum physicists and mathematicians would best use to find a unified theory or theory of everything, or should we not be looking for a unified theory?
Oh, sure, you can look for a unified theory of everything on my terms, because it won't affect anything that much, because the whole is always less than the sum of its parts. So you've got everything, right? You've got this universal, like, say, for example, it's a universal energy field created, but just for example, created by life forms that sort of surrounds and penetrates us. I don't know where I got this idea from, but some little large green guy. Say that's the top level. That doesn't get rid of, like, spoons and stuff. That doesn't get rid of, like, spoons and people and rabbits and stuff like that. That's just, like, the top level. So it's like the Higgs field. You know, they've discovered this kind of energy field, and at first they were like, well, this energy field is responsible for giving things mass. Now they think it's actually a bit too weak for that, which is interesting. But it's a very specific, this Higgs field. It's like it's got a certain frequency to it. And that's the cool thing about quantum theory. It means everything is super specific, right? You've got your electromagnetic field. It's got this particular frequency. Let's call it red. And then you've got the Higgs field that enables that field to exist. Let's call it green. And green is not fighting red. You've got little ocean of red inside a big ocean of green, right? And everything's kind of like that, yeah? Inside this big ocean of green, there are thousands of millions and trillions of other little oceans. One of them is called you, one of them is called your hairdo, one of them is called one hair of your hairdo, one of them is called a little molecule of your hair, of your hairdo. All these things aren't getting rid of each other, right? There's no problem. He said wittily.